Centennial Week for Final Women around the world. Good morning, everyone. I'm with Dawn Davis, and this is the Morning Edition. And as always, it's so great to have you waking up with us. Still some cool temperatures lingering around the islands today. But for more on your weather outlook for the week, here's Chief Meteorologist Basil Dean.
This weather report is sponsored by Bank of the Bahamas, the Bank of Solutions.
Good morning, LaDawn. We have a strong area of high pressure, which will continue to generate fresh breezes throughout the 700 islands today. But outside of our studios, we are under partly cloudy skies. Your temperature, 73 degrees, relative humidity at 86%. We have east-southeast winds at 10 miles per hour. The barometric pressure, 1,025.1 millibars. That's 30.28 inches, and it is steady. Your temperatures around the islands this morning, we're picking up 70 degrees in Greentoke Key. Also, Freeport at 70 degrees. 74 in Marsh Harbor, Abaco, the Berry Islands, 75 in Alistan, Bimini. We're picking up 75 in Harbor Island, Roxanne, Elutra, Alistan, Cat Island, Sanu Key at 74 in Kemp's Bay, on Andros, also Fresh Creek in Central Andros at 75 degrees. Further south, San Salvador, 75, Rim Key at 75, 77 in Georgetown, Exuma, 76 in Ragged Island, Acklands, Betsy Bay, Maguana, Matutan, Niagara, 77, and the Turks and Caicos Islands at 78 degrees. And if you're traveling this morning, we'll hear some high and low temperatures you're likely to find at some of your favorite cities. And that's going to do it for your travel forecast. Now for your boating forecast for today in the northwestern parts of our country, easterly winds at 15 to 20 knots, wave heights 4 to 7 feet over the ocean, so caution flags up for boaters in the northwest Bahamas. Your high tide, that will take place at 9:32 this morning, low tide at 4:01 in the afternoon. Now for the central and southeastern islands, we're asking small craft to simply stay in port. Very rough sea conditions, winds out of the east at 20 to 30 knots, wave heights at very rough 9 to 12 feet over the ocean. And that's going to do it for your first look at weather the morning edition. Stay tuned. Your forecast for today and tonight is still ahead.
Thanks a lot, Basil. We can also expect some bumper-to-bumper traffic as our little darlings head back to the classroom this morning. Lloyd Allen and the Morning Edition team is standing by with the Bahamas First Traffic Report.
The Traffic Report is sponsored by Bahamas First. First in insurance, today, tomorrow.
Well, good morning, LaDawn. Good morning, Bahamas. I hope you had some great rest over the weekend. It's going to be a great week this morning. We are reporting your traffic from the roundabout near the University of the Bahamas. This is where Nassau Street connects with University Drive. So far this morning, we've seen several commuters on the road making their way to their various destinations. And of course, we would like to advise drivers, those using the Nassau Street area, particularly the southbound lane, that lane is under repair. And of course, we would like to advise drivers to approach that area with caution and care as they make their way to their various destinations. This morning, we're also joined by Sergeant Crustinier Johnson from the Royal Bahamas Police Force Traffic Division. Good morning, Officer Johnson. How are you?
A pleasant good morning to you and a pleasant good morning, Bahamas.
All right. I hope you had a great weekend. Give us a look at traffic incidents over the weekend.
Okay. We're coming out with 8 hit-and-run accidents, and the majority of which were in the Tawny, Darling, and Blue Hill Road area. We've had 35 minor accidents, and we've also had 25 accidents just involving damages.
Well, and I know one of the things that we talked about earlier was the fact, particularly in this area, we talk about high traffic areas and accidents being prone to happen. What advice can you give drivers, particularly in this area and those in other areas, to be aware and to be alert?
Well, for the most part, if we look around this particular area, we say that this is a high pedestrian traffic area. We have the banks here, we have the eateries, we have the University of the Bahamas, we also have the local schools. So what we're advising the general public to do is what we always try to impose, is that is to avoid distracted driving. Any activity that takes your attention away from driving and looking at the road and making sure that you're doing the right thing, operating your vehicle in the correct manner, please avoid those activities. That's eating, that's using your cell phone, that's having a lively conversation in your vehicle, that's taking your attention away from the street, anything along that line.
Now, of course, being alert is one thing, but it's going to prove that much more important, especially if an accident happens. Now, you told me earlier that there were several hit and runs over the weekend. What can drivers do to better prepare themselves?
Again, like we said, distracted driving. Paying attention is the main thing when you're on the street. That's what I can advise, mostly for you to pay attention, because if you're driving and somebody hits you, of course, you go through that period of shock. You're going to try to figure out at that particular moment, hey, did I just get hit? So after you've basically recovered from that, you should become alert. Take down that license plate number if possible. Take down the color of the vehicle, the description. Direction they travel into, all of this information, anything that you can get to assist the investigators once they come to that scene.
And then finally, early last week, we talked about an unfortunate incident involved in the Johnson Road area involving a child that was involved in an accident. And do you have an update for us?
Well, I can only say that investigations are continuing into this matter. We are still trying to get an update from the hospital as we speak. They are on the line getting an update on the child. We hope that he is well, that he's a fighter. Investigations continue, so I'll update you on that further, probably in the morning.
I appreciate that, definitely. And, of course, it's a great start to Monday morning. And, LaDawn, I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to some great Starbucks this morning. Back to you in studio.
To our top story this morning, the private sector stepping up to assist the Bahamas to rebuild from the devastation left behind by Hurricane Dorian. Today, key stakeholders will assemble in a pledging conference to generate and establish a trust fund. The pledging conference, which opens this morning at the Bahama Resort, is being spearheaded by the United Nations Development Program, the government of the Bahamas, and with the support of the international community. Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Disaster Preparedness, Carl Smith, says the expectation is for a successful conclave.
We've been working diligently for a number of weeks ahead of the conference itself, and we are quite pleased thus far with the pledges that have been made. And so I'm very confident that we will have a successful event. I want to thank those who've already contributed, and there will be established a fund which will provide transparency for all the funds in terms of how the funds are expended.
This morning, the conference will hear from the Prime Minister and the United Nations Assistant Secretary General. Two students from Abaco and Grand Bahama will also share their experiences during the last storm. Last evening, an exhibition opened at the conference site with exhibitors showcasing innovative technology that can be used in the rebuilding process.
The recovery efforts have been going quite well. We have quite a bit of debris to still be removed, particularly from the marine environment. But all considerations taken into account, it is going quite well, and we expect for the process to be accelerated. We are moving towards the rebuilding of more homes, roads, schools, clinics in the health sector, and all of those will kick into stream as we move forward in the next months ahead.
It's been 4 months now since evacuees have been housed at the Kendall Jill Isaacs Gymnasium and the Bahamas Academy hurricane shelters, and there has been quite a number of questions regarding time spent there. However, Minister of Social Services, the Honorable Frankie Campbell, is clearing the air on the timeline evacuees were expected to vacate those emergency shelters.
We're continuing to put the figures together, particularly we now at the end of the year tallying up and preparing for a midterm budget. So those figures will be available shortly. But they are above and beyond what we would have anticipated in the budget that was passed 1st July.
Now, as for the budget moving forward, the minister anticipates after the toll associated with Hurricane Dorian, an increase may be necessary. In the last budget allocation, the Department of Social Services received $39 million, a slight decrease from the year before when it was about $39.7 million.
We're continuing to put the figures together, particularly we now at the end of the year tallying up and preparing for a midterm budget. So those figures will be available shortly, but they are above and beyond what we would have anticipated
in the budget that was passed 1st July.
The teachers' union is in talks with education officials over a new contract. Minister of Education, the Honorable Jeffrey Lloyd, says negotiations for new industrial agreements with educators and administrators are set to resume. He anticipates a smooth process despite some contentious issues.
In the process now of resuming negotiations, which we expect to be, you know, very smooth. There shouldn't be any challenges and difficulties. Naturally, the more challenging and difficult part of that is the issue of money, which resides more specifically in the Ministry of Finance. But again, I don't think that that's really going to. I believe that the attitude of each of the partners, the negotiating teams on the Bahamas Union of Teachers and the Ministry of Education, wishes to see that this matter gets to be resolved as quickly as possible for the benefit of our teachers and administrators. Because, I mean, I say administrators because they are both unions are now in the process of renegotiations. That's the Bahamas Union of Teachers as well as Bahamas Education and Managers Union. So we don't expect any.
Meanwhile, Minister of Public Works, the Honorable Desmond Bannister, says the government is looking into the process of updating the Bahamas' building code. After Hurricane Dorian, the government said buildings that were damaged will be assessed with a view to determine whether the building code last updated in 2003 should be modified. Bannister says the minister responsible for disaster recovery, Iram Lewis, has been meeting with the building controls officer within the Ministry of Public Works and has been consulting with the University of Miami as they examine the process of updating that building code. Also, a number of streets in the capital will soon get some much-needed repairs and upgrades, including repaving and widening. Minister Bannister says the ministry is going through a process to ensure that Nassau Street, East Street, and Village Road can serve the country for decades to come and accommodate the smooth flow of traffic. And still to come, the deadline is approaching for the annual Cacique Awards. We have the latest, and we've also got a feature on the art of dancing, so keep it locked.
If you or a loved one has an illness or has had surgery that requires rehabilitation, Doctors Hospital Rehab Center is here for you. Our comprehensive, multi-facility rehabilitation program is committed to enabling patients to reach and maintain their maximum level of functional independence. Our goal is simple, to get you back to the life you love. Doctors Hospital offers a full range of services for patients, including physical therapy, occupational therapy, aquatic therapy and rehab, speech and language pathology, and more. And with two locations for you to choose from, you will find that putting our patients first philosophy is a part of everything we do. Visit Doctors Hospital today to begin your road to recovery.
Shopping made easy right at your fingertips with the number one online grocery shopping app in the Bahamas. You can now order online from a variety of trusted brands and at the best prices in town. Once you place your order, our team will gather it, package it, and deliver it. So no more wasting time at the grocery store. Get the best online grocery shopping and delivery experience with the push of a button. Fast shipping anywhere in the Bahamas and free delivery anywhere in Nassau with a minimum purchase. Download the app today.
Hi, welcome to Dream Girls. We offer a wide variety of hair, hair care, and your everyday beauty needs.
Hey, Dream Girls, we carry a wide variety of products for natural or relaxed hair, such as ORX, Hero Care, and Shea Moisture. We also carry a large selection of weaving, braiding, and crochet hair. You can expect to find a private wig room, a large variety of products, and service with a smile. Whether you're shopping for a party, a corporate event, or your everyday working woman, Dream Girls can make your dream become a reality. Live your dream, experience your dream, Dream Girls.
We have three convenient locations to serve you. Village Road Shopping Center, Prince Charles Shopping Center, and Legacy Plaza located on Prince Charles next to BTC Cash & Go. Here at Dream Girls, enhancing beauty becomes your reality.
Every dream needs a gentle push. Every tomorrow needs a warm embrace. Every ambition needs hope to take flight and the faith to pursue a unique goal. At Commonwealth Bank, we make it happen for you. Today, tomorrow, and into the future. Commonwealth Bank. Everything we do it for you.
Welcome to Sunshine Auto, your hottest place on the planet for rims, tints, tires, and auto sales. We are your auto superstore for rims, Lexani, Azaras, Trueform, Western, Lux, Fuel, Tracklight, Tough, Rough Racing, Velocity, Mud, All Terrain, and Local Fire Tires. Cars, homes, and commercial window tinting. At Sunshine Auto, we put God first and customer is king. Blessed luck.
Hey y'all, what's up?
Hey, what's that?
What y'all getting?
Listen, I've been waiting to mash down some lobster, yeah?
Hi, I'm Matthew. I will be you guys waiter today. Can I take your order?
Oh, I've been queuing for some group of dread.
Y'all see this?
See, this ain't gonna work.
Where the fish gone, though?
But how, though?
Don't leave our children with no fish in their future. Protect our sea. Protect our way of life. Protect the Bahamas. To learn how you can help, find us on Facebook at Bahamas Protected. See the future.
The prestigious Cacique Awards may be months away, but the countdown is on for the nomination process. Antoinette Smith is live in studio with the details. Good morning, Antoinette.
That's right. Behind the number one industry that is tourism, there are a number of average, everyday unsung heroes who do their job to ensure the Bahamas remains a top-tier travel destination. And recognizing and bringing those unsung heroes to light is the Cacique Awards. Joining us in studio this morning is Cacique Awards Executive Director Charlie M. Brister and Director Megan Myers. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Thanks for having us.
Okay, so for those who don't know, what is the Cacique Awards?
Good morning, Bahamas. The Cacique Awards is excellence in service delivery and tourism management. Persons go day in and day out working very hard to maintain our status in the world in tourism, and we just want to honor those persons who really go above and beyond. And so this is the 18th Cacique Awards, and we're asking persons to nominate those deserving persons in our communities. You have your aunts, your colleagues, all family members. You look around and you know those persons who go above and beyond. And we want to single those persons out and recognize them.
So the nomination process it's going on right now this month.
Absolutely.
And the awards isn't actually until May. So gearing up for the awards, what is going on in terms of the nomination process?
So the nomination process ends January 31st. So there's a very short window for persons to nominate. We have a total of about 25 categories. We have 11 local categories, and those would entail artisans, creative arts, sports and leisure, special events, sustainable tourism, and the list goes on. In addition to that, there is the awards of all awards, the Lifetime Achievement Award. And as persons might recall, Enrico Gazzaroli won the Lifetime Achievement Award for the last cacique. And so we're asking Bahamians to nominate those deserving persons. There's another, perhaps almost 2 weeks, January 31st. You can go to the website, which is kasikawards.com. You can visit the local tourist offices throughout the islands. And for those offices where we, those islands where we do not have an office, persons can get application forms, nomination forms from the administrator's office. And so we've left nothing unturned. And we're also accepting nominations, of course, from Grand Bahama and Abaco, because we have our offices still functioning for the most part. So we don't want to leave them out. And the idea of this year's Cacique Awards is to show persons that we are still rocking.
So who is exactly, the Lifetime Achievement is a big deal, who exactly is eligible for a nomination in that category, and who is eligible for a nomination in general?
So persons who are residents, Bahamians, you have to would have been in the industry and showing excellence over a period of time on a sustainable basis. So it's not just for a one-off good performance. These are persons who, on a day-to-day basis, show excellence in service delivery and tourism management. The Lifetime Achievement winner, that's someone who would have been providing a service and creating growth in the tourism product over numerous years. And so we're just asking persons to look around and nominate someone for one of those many categories. In addition to that, we have seven categories from the hotels. And those categories really show executives, chef of the year, employee of the year, front of house, and back of house.
Now, Megan, you are the director, producer of the Cacique Awards. So how, in the months gearing up, how have you been preparing? I know you're responsible for a huge role.
Yes, when Charity called us to produce, direct and design the Cacique Awards, we felt the need to ensure that we kept up with the theme, and the theme being still rocking. So we're hoping that persons who attend the show, they feel that the minute they walk in the door. So I'm hoping to, without giving too much away, we're hoping to have audible gas as soon as people walk in the show. We're taking the design in a very technology-driven direction. So we're showcasing a lot of LED, a lot of digital, a lot of animation, a lot of mapping. So we're just hoping that this show is really dynamic and fresh and futuristic and new, and showcasing what tourism is in the Bahamas, telling the story of all these years of great things that the ministry has done, and ensuring that the persons who are nominated feel that this was for them.
Now, I know you can't give us too much, and you've already said that, but in terms of Razzle Dazzle, what can we expect?
You can expect an Oscar-worthy lights, camera, action, performances, dance, music, original scores. You can expect the high energy, just Bahamian, feel it in your soul kind of performances. We're hoping that all of the presenters, the host, everybody who's in it, there's just going to be a high energy, really technology driven show.
For both of you, it must have been a lot of work, a lot of time. Yes. So what's the whole process been like, just working together, collaborating to make a good show come May?
So right now we're working with predominantly an all-female team, and we have from stage direction to design to decor to technical direction, and right now we're just in the planning stages of every different department. So we have a timeline, and we are very ambitiously decided that we're going to have a complete show by the end of April. And with that in mind, every week there is new elements, there is new portions of the script that needs to be completed, there are new sections for music and the original scores that need to be created. So there's tons of planning still going on.
Again, a part of that script that's still not written yet are those nominations. So even though the nominations are due at the end of January, when do we hear who the nominees are?
Okay, so that's quite a process. And once nominations are closed, we take about a week to a week and a half. We have a pre-selection committee who goes through all the nominations, and they take out the best of the best. And those nominations go on to the Blue Ribbon Panel, which is a group of distinguished Bahamians who will labor tirelessly to come up with three finalists. And out of those three finalists, one of those persons will become the winner. And so we're hoping to perhaps make that announcement as early as perhaps in March or somewhere about there. And at that same time, we will announce the Lifetime Achievement Award winner. However, only the finalists will be announced, because we have to keep that level of surprise for the awards, for the winner.
Megan, for the question that is on everyone's mind, I know like you are in charge of the production, but what can we expect that is new, that sets it apart from all the other years before?
I think predominantly the design, the actual story that we're going to tell, we're going to do it in a different way as well. Now, again, I can't give any details. It's top secret, so you have to come out and come to the show. But I think this year's design is something that just hasn't been seen ever here in the Bahamas. So we really want to showcase that we can step it up and have that global awards production. So that's.
And we also want to remind the public to watch out for the People's Choice. And that is the music part of the awards. We have the secular as well as gospel. And those are done online. And so stay tuned for more information so that you can nominate your favorite artist or group.
Can we expect any surprise performances from those artists nominated?
Yes.
Come out, purchase your tickets, and come out and see.
Well, they can't give too much away, but the process is ongoing for the nominations and the whole award show in general. For more information, you can tune into the website at thekasikawards.com.
Thanks a lot, Antoine. The Art of Dance has taken Bahamian dancer and instructor Courtney Spears to Broadway and around the world. The young Bahamian, who is the granddaughter of breast cancer survivor Andrea Sweeting, offered the young and the young at heart dance lessons as a way to give back to her community through her Art C program. I sat down with the gifted dancer prior to her workshop this past weekend to discuss the importance of the workshop routines offered, where it's going, and the future of arts here in the Bahamas. We're here at the Windsor School in Old Fort, and we're in preparation for a special dance workshop. Now I'm joined by the dance instructor, Courtney Spears. Courtney, welcome to the Morning Edition.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
So Courtney, talk to us a little bit about your dance workshop. What does it actually entail, and who are you trying to attract?
So I created Artsy Dance as a way to bring all of the dancers and young artists within the Bahamas and in the community together. This was my third workshop I had this past summer. We were having our fourth, but in between, I wanted to find a way to connect with students while I was home. I just finished my second season with the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater at our big New York holiday season. So I thought, you know, there wouldn't be a better option than making sure I saw everybody again just for one day. I'm very, very excited to be able to be in the front of the room and be the one instructing. It'll be a modern contemporary class with a lot of different techniques, a lot of warm-ups, some stretching, some moving, a nice combination at the end. So I'm kind of modeling it after what a classic New York contemporary modern class would be for anybody who came overseas, just to kind of bring that type of structure within an hour and a half for all age groups between 8 and above. I see these kids and I'll teach them something and they'll just do it. They'll just move their bodies and just do it. And I remember when I learned that, and it took me so much longer. So I think that they're manageable. The class really will be a place that is judgment-free. It's just fun. You know, I do this because I love to, and I'm having fun. I want it to be fun. So, you know, there's this unfortunate notion that dance is not a career option, that it's not something that that can be your main source of income, that it can be a career. And I really want to change that idea. Dance has taken me all over the world. I've been to Paris, London, Switzerland, Denmark, the Netherlands, just all over because of what I love to do and the fact that I was able to pursue it. And so it's what I love to do. It's my passion. And I've always wanted to dedicate my own career to coming home and inspiring young dancers and giving them a platform and trying to give dance the respect and the funding and support that it needs. I think, you know, dance is embedded within our culture. It's embedded here in Junkanoo and our roots, and there's so much natural talent here. Even with the teachers and friends that I bring here to teach, they come to the Bahamas and they're amazed at the natural rhythm that these young kids have. They're so far ahead than so many other kids, even in the U.S. And so I would love to see a performing arts center. I would love to see dance in college programs, dance in educational programs and public schools. I would love to see it with the same respect and love and acceptance as sports. I love what I do. I feel so blessed to do it every day, but being home, being here, being with Artsy truly makes it full circle, and it makes it all feel like it has a larger purpose. I don't believe that our lives are for our own. They're really meant to circle back, and so this is my circle.
Let's turn to your hair and what it may say about your personality. It's a form of self-expression and maintenance of your natural hair, as it's very important. Here's Crystal Darling.
Wearing caps, extensions, and other hair pieces is quite popular these days. They bump up your hairstyles for a change from the regular look. But did you know that add-ons are not a permanent solution to bad hair days? Owner of True Beauty Salon and hair care professional Shanice Carey provides some pointers on how to maintain a healthy scalp and hair.
You take care of the natural hair by not leaving the hair on like a whole 6 weeks. I recommend anything after a month can be damaging. So even if you have your hair for 6 weeks, after 3 weeks, I would recommend you come and get your hair shampoo, get your scalp oil. You know, we check out the scalp, make sure everything's going well, because you don't know what's going on in your body, and whatever going on can affect your scalp. Even with some hair, if you don't wash it on time, your face break out and all that other stuff. So all of that you have to be mindful of.
Carrie says that treatment may vary based on customer preferences, but it is essential to always keep the scalp moisturized.
You know, we, according to the customer, we would do what's best. And definitely oil in the scalp while the cap is on. Or if you like me, every night you take it off and put it back on every morning. Or some days you just don't wear your cap. You put it down and just wear it when you're going out for occasions. But always keep your scalp oil.
Here's some advice for those with health complications which can affect the scalp.
Sometimes when you have those diseases, it itches a lot. So you can put like oils and natural coconut oil, castor oil, olive oil is a very good oil as well. So I recommend all these things for people who have those issues.
And what you put on your hair isn't the only thing you need to pay attention to health-wise.
What you eat affects your whole lifestyle. There's a lot of people that are doing vegan diets and, you know, diets, but the most important thing for any growth is water. So we have to drink a lot of water. You should always take your vitamins, because the older you get, your body is not producing what's needed to keep your hair nice and healthy, keep your skin nice and shiny and beautiful. So you got to take your vitamins, make sure you eat your fruits and vegetables, like mommy always say, and drink a lot of water. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Try to stay away from the grease and the fry, and do more bacon and, you know, more fruits and vegetables, and you'll see a difference in your skin and in your hair.
Crystal Darling, ZNS Network News.
Some great hair tips there, Crystal. Thanks a lot. Stay close. We've got more right after this. You're watching The Morning Edition.
It's the OT with yours truly, Charles Fisher.
Buddy Hield and the Kings have their...
Buddy Hield seemed to be having the best season of his career. 32 points the other night. It was a bit disappointing, Shawnee Miller not winning the IAAF World Female Athlete of the Year. The high school rankings will soon be out. Tabernacle, the defending champion, CC Sweeting, they are always there. Who will it be this year? Each Monday on 1540 AM and 104.5 FM, it's the OT with yours truly, Charles Fisher.
YCare Fashion is here to cater to your every need. They have the best in jeans,
shoes, tennis, children's clothing and underwear, and also dicky wear. But wait, it gets better. They also provide bedding and appliances. So now you can get your fridge, stove, flat screen TV, and so much more. Be sure to visit Y Care Fashion at any of their three locations, Prince Charles Drive, Bahama Avenue, and East Street South.
From day one, Classic was there. Now at graduation, we're hand in hand.
I'm a classic man. You can be me when you look this clean. I'm a classic man.
Even at my wedding day, who else could dress us? My wife and I.
Your knees get met by the street, elegant, old-fashioned man. Yeah, baby, I'm a classic man.
Classic formal wear, the place where you can find everything you need for that special occasion.
Your knees get met by the street, elegant, old-fashioned man. Yeah, baby, I'm a classic man.
Classic formal wear, setting the standard for excellence.
Diabetic eye disease is caused by changes in the blood vessels of your retina. This disease is the most common cause of vision loss among patients with diabetes and is the leading cause of blindness and visual impairment in working age adults. Symptoms of diabetic eye disease can include floaters in your vision, blurred vision, fluctuating vision, impaired color vision, or generalized loss of vision. Smoking can quadruple your risk of progression of this disease. Bottom line is, smoking will cause you to go blind faster with diabetes. So quit smoking. Also, for expectant mothers who are diabetic, it is very important that you have your eyes examined during pregnancy, as rapid changes can occur in your eyes during pregnancy. And remember, good eye health is a combined effort between your eye care team, your medical doctors, and you, the patient.
This public service announcement is brought to you by the Public Hospitals Authority in conjunction with the Medical Association of the Bahamas and the Broadcasting Corporation of the Bahamas.
Hey, long time no see.
You hear me?
Long time no see.
Oil fish, stew conch, I love it all.
Tourists come here to take our tours, experience our sun, sand, and sea, and they also spend money around town.
I used to see a bunch of hogfish around here, but nowadays, I hardly see any.
You protect one area, the fish do they think, make a bunch of babies that spread all over the sea. What's the problem?
If we protect certain parts of our sea, it keeps all parts working right.
I was against that phase, but knowing what I know now, I totally agree with having marine protected areas.
I support marine protected areas.
We support marine protected areas.
Look for Bahamas Protected on Facebook.
Sign the petition. Sign the petition.
Underway for the 48th annual Red Cross Ball. It's considered the premier ball as it's one of the first in the year. The event will be held under the patronage of the Governor General, His Excellency the Most Honorable Cornelius Smith, Red Cross President Therese Curry.
We are raising funds for the continuation of our Meals on Wheels as we feed approximately 158 persons 6 days a week. And so that requires funding. We also have our youth program in which we help youth in the Baines and Grantstown area with homework and projects and so on. And we give them a little something to eat at the end. And so funding again required for that. So we are encouraging all of our corporate sponsors, all Bahamians alike, to join us at the 48th annual Red Cross Ball on the 25th of January.
Individual tickets for the event are priced at $275. Meantime, Ball Chair Cindy Williams-Ramming says the event is one not to be missed, with entertainment from the Police Force Pop Band to the Lou Adams Orchestra, with facades rounding off the event. But she says that's not all.
We will also have prizes given out throughout the evening, door prizes and a grand raffle prize, which will consist of a trip for two to Amsterdam. Those particular tickets will be $100 per ticket. We have sold, I think, 3 to 4 platinum tables, so we're encouraging persons, particularly as the president would have mentioned, we've come through a hurricane of a disastrous nature that we've never experienced in the Bahamas before. And so we certainly need extra funding in preparations for such in the future, as well as to continue our operational expenses daily.
Men, women, and children all gathered at the First Baptist Church on Sunday to participate in the 4th Annual Baptist Men Concert and Competition. This year, the men's department honored senior pastor of St. Paul's Baptist Church, Reverend Carl Ramming, for his work in ministry. Reverend Stephen Ferguson, National Baptist Men Department Director, says his concert commemorates the beginning of a fruitful new year and honors a loyal member.
We kick off the year with a concert accommodating all of the various men department concert that is held throughout the year. All of the men are gathered here today. Various choirs will be here in attendance. In every service that we went to pertaining to the men, we had Bishop Carl Ramming there with us, and so we are honoring him today and showing our appreciation to him for this day.
Honoree Pastor Carl Ramming says he is grateful, and last year's Best Men Choir winner, President Wellington Miller, says events like this are good for men in our community.
Honored persons before, but I am very happy in that they remembered me this year. You know, and when I think in terms of past services rendered to the convention, and in particularly the men's department, I am humbled that they've considered me 2020, you know?
Good, this is good for men in our community, to see that men taking part in this kind of work, singing in the church, and having fun while they're doing it, along with other men and other churches. Come on down and join the organization. You don't have to be a part of the choir, but you could be a part of the church, a waking man in the church. But, you know, if you could sing, or even if you can't sing, come and join us.
Here in the Bahamas, following the damaging effects of Hurricane Dorian, environmental preservation has advanced to the front line and is fueling a number of projects, among them a new animated series titled Nassau Rock. Lloyd Allen met with the project's creator to get an update on the series set to premiere this summer.
This morning, we're talking with Maz Joshin. He's the producer of a local production animation called Nassau Rock. It's set to hit the big screen in August. Check it out. Maz Joshin, how are you?
I'm doing all right.
All right, good. So talk to me. Yeah, talk to me about what's happening.
Okay, well, Nassau Rock, like we spoke the last time, it's an animated short show. And there's about 7 members in Streetlight Studios, Animation Studios. Myself, Rashad Cash, Netsonette Weir, Sydney Munnings, I almost forgot her name, Cameron Johnson, Stephen Catalano, and Chris Willey. And we're aiming for July. So our production already started late last year. And so we'll be done by the end of May.
We first introduced you to Nassau Rock last October. Since then, Johnson says much of the final prep has been completed in fine-tuning the 3 main characters.
We've kind of restructured a couple of the characters. Now, this is very exclusive. I wasn't even supposed to show this, but, you know, people like exclusivity. So what we did was we redesigned a few characters just for movement's sake, and we kind of broke down certain characteristics, what the characters look like. Do their looks match their behaviors? Each character is unique in their upbringing and the way they're designed. And so what we've done from the last time we spoke, we've really basically just kind of restructured characters so we could get the product done more efficiently, you know, and as quick as possible. Because animation is a timely process, especially when it's not something that you're doing full time. So yeah, I think that's been a big help, just kind of restructuring the characters.
Johnson also spoke about inspiration as he has the passion for creating animation, comics, and even music.
You know, most artists are kind of messy. That's just how we are. We like to just grab things. But for me, I read a lot of books. So I always have books to the right of me. Whenever I'm working on anything, if I get stuck on an idea, I'll just pick up a book that I read. So currently I'm reading, those books up there are what I'm currently reading. These are the ones I've already read. But then I also have comic books. I think that's important too, because a great artist knows how to take reference. He knows how to look at other people's work and see what informs their work, what makes them that stand out to you. So I whenever I feel like I just can't draw, if I get an artist block, it's really easy to pick myself out of that because I just have to look to my right.
With a number of additions to the team, Johnson says he is happy that together they will be able to create an amazing product for audiences. As for advice for future animators,
there's this misconception that comics are just not a lot of work. You're just having a good time. That is not true. Okay? It's not true. It's a myth. Anything that you want to do is going to require a certain level of hard work. So my advice to any artist is take your art seriously. You know, you have to be very serious about what it is you're trying to do. Draw consistently. Look at references. If you hear there's a class being given for anatomy, go take that class. Especially if you're in school, usually they're free. We now live in the age of technology. You can go online. Just consume.
Now, although a venue for the premiere has not been finalized, Johnson says he is looking forward to positive feedback from local viewers.
You will, of course, be the first on-site to cover the premiere of this awesome NASA Rock as it premieres right here in the Bahamas. LaDon, back to you in studio.
Very creative, Bahamian. Thanks a lot, Lloyd Fisher. I know you saw earlier in the newscast, you saw me getting my dance moves together.
I learned two new things this morning, and some ladies will be happy, Shane, that plastic band does not extend to hair weave. And I also learned that you still don't have no rhythm.
I do. I'm sure I could beat you, though.
I called up a friend, and we got you a $50 gift certificate for
LaDon.
You can use this anytime, yes. A $50 gift
certificate.
To learn some rhythm. Again, here's a plastic elastic band to help you learn how to stretch, because what you was doing this morning, I don't sure if you break something.
Oh, gosh, Fisher, what's coming up in sports?
Coming up in sports is history-making week, because we have some high-level officials in town from the NACAC, the World Athletics. Mike Sands is going to be sworn in as the new president, first time ever for the Bahamas. Are you going to take this gift certificate?
I'm going to show you my moves.
$50 gift certificate.
I'm going to take it.
Learn rhythm. R-I-D-I-M. Because what you was doing this morning was rhythm.
All of that and more ahead in sports. Thank you, Fisher.
Janae's Chesapeake Road is having a big, big tent clearance sale. Everything must go. Christmas decorations, toys, bridal and formal wear. Everything must go. Get up to 75% off. Up to 75% off everything under the tent, including the tent. Big, big savings on decorative mesh, Christmas ornaments, wreaths, Christmas lights, girls and boys' toys, standard bikes and electronic bikes. Hurry into Janae's Chesapeake Road Big, Big Tent clearance sale. No exchanges or refunds on sale items. All sales final.
The SEEK Award honors persons who have demonstrated the highest level of achievement in the tourism and hospitality sector.
I nominate my granddaddy because tourism is his passion. Every day he drives his taxi and shows our visitors why it is truly better in the Bahamas.
Honoring straw vendors, hoteliers, musicians, artists, photographers, airlines, and so much more. Nominate your choice today. Visit kasikawards.com or your local tourism office. The 18th Kasik Awards will be held May 23rd, 2020, showing the world the Bahamas is still rocking.
And the Kasik Award,
Kasik Award.
And the Kasik Award goes to...
Base tourism supplies almost $50 million in revenue for Androsians every year. These priceless resources will continue to provide renewable benefits for thousands of people for years to come, as long as we take long-term action to preserve what's rightfully ours. The natural environment has played a vital role in our culture and economy for generations. Let's take care of nature, and nature will take care of us.
Good Monday morning, everybody. It's a history-making week for track and field here as Mike Sands will be officially sworn in as the new president of NACAC. That's the North American, Central American, and Caribbean region of track and field. And the office opening right here in the 242 on Tuesday. Many top delegates of track and field world is here, including president of the World Athletics Congress, formerly the IAAF, Lord Sebastian Coe, along with former president of NACAC, Victor Lopez, former Olympic triple jump champion, American Willie Banks, also here for the festivities. And for the first time ever, a NACAC meeting will be held in the Bahamas, and that goes this morning from 8:15 to 9:30. From there, the delegates will pay a visit to Government House for a courtesy call. 12 noon to 2 o'clock, they'll be hosted to a luncheon by the Beach Race and Marathon Bahamas. Then it's back to meetings from 2:45 to 5 o'clock. And then the session will close out with a 5 to 6 o'clock meeting trackside with athletes, coaches at the Thomas Robinson Track and Field Stadium. And then later on this evening, it's a reception being hosted by the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture. Big week of track and field here in the Bahamas. Once again, the official opening will be held of the office on Tuesday at the Thomas A. Robinson Stadium. Freedom Farm Baseball League opens its 31st season this past Saturday at the grounds in Yamacraw. On hand was former players Todd Isaacs and Anthony Seymour, who was giving back with a free clinic for the future pro sluggers.
When I started to play baseball, I look up to guys like Greg Burrows, Albert Cartwright, Anton Richardson, Jaron Sands. You know, those were my idols coming up. You know, and the doors they opened for me, you know, I'd like to come back and give back and open the same doors for some of the little kids here today. Every year, you know, we try to make it a little better, you know. I thank Natasha Watley, who always comes down and assists with girls softball here in the country. And, you know, just anything we can do to make a change, you know, and promote baseball and get it out there, you know, we're willing to do. But every year we're looking to make it bigger and better, and hopefully this can continue for a very long time to come.
Freedom Baptist Majority Rule Basketball Tournament deemed a success. Temple Christian ringing the mini primary girls and boys division. Donald Davis Junior Boys and St. John's took the junior girls. Tournament coach Josiah Major looking to improve in one division in particular.
Girls, they need more games, all right? And in order for us to get our kids better in the Bahamas, they have to play more games. We're not getting enough games. All right, so it's all a matter of getting some more repetition in and developing our kids, especially the girls. All the teams that we wanted to come and invited to come, they didn't come, but the competition was great. We had D.W. Davis versus Telios earlier, Freedom Baptist versus Anatole. Those games were crazy, they were fun. Next year, we're looking at doing a senior tournament outside of the majority rule tournament, probably sometime down the line in the timetable. So this one means a lot, also because of what happened last year with the storm, and you have the Hugh Campbell not available. We missed Father Marston. The kids just want to play, man.
Longtime females coach Terrence Redeye McSweeney having his girls hoop it up for him. Two, getting the girls to play more games and more tournaments will only help.
Much needed tournament for my girls. We still have some things to work on because I don't know if you know, I don't know if you know, but there are 13 teams, 13 schools in BISS. Only 6 schools saw it fit to put a team from their school to represent. So 6 teams, that means we only get 5 games. This is the only way you're going to know what's going up to your senior program by playing junior.
What's the goal for this team this year?
The young girls that you would have seen, they actually are the ones who benefit from us. We actually come to say, get some experience, let us see where we at, and see what we need to work on.
What does this say about basketball in the private schools? There's only 6 of the 13 schools represented.
The Providence Basketball Association, they are into the stretch run with the second half of their season getting underway tonight with Lenos Regulators against Breezes High Flyers. Triple K Stambus will take on the Asphalt Maintenance Pirates. League President James Price on how things have been so far.
Well, so far, we have a great season, you know. If you look at it, 21 team, undefeated, everybody else right there in the mix, you know. So from the top 1 to 6, you know, anybody could win the league.
Well, the OT is back this morning, and we have Ken Mullings, who returned this weekend from the Gene Edmonds Invitational Track and Field Classic at Purdue University, where he broke his mark in the heptathlon, leading to a number two world ranking. He, along with second-place finisher Kendrick Thompson and coach Ednell Rule, will be in studio on 15:40 a.m., 104.5 FM, and on the Zednet Television Network. On the OT with yours truly at 9 o'clock, make sure to tune in for that. The OT is back. And that's going to do it for sports. I'm Charles Fisher. Thanks for watching.
When a hurricane strikes, there are many critical needs to survival. Water is one of them. Access to clean water to drink, bathe, and wash things is often hard to come by, particularly in remote areas. While it's tempting to use whatever water is available, there are a few things that you should do to make sure that your drinking water is safe to consume or use. Boiling your water is one of them. Boiling water kills most pathogens that can be harmful. If your water is cloudy, filter it through a clean cloth or portable filter. You should boil filtered water for 1 minute, cool, and then store in a clean container with a lid. If boiling your water is not an option, you can disinfect it with bleach. Use 1/8 teaspoon or 8 drops per gallon, then let it stand for 30 minutes. Remember, this water should be stored in a clean container with a lid. Ensuring the highest level of food, animal, and plant safety in the Bahamas. This message is brought to you by the Bahamas Agricultural Health and Food Safety Authority and the Broadcasting Corporation of the Bahamas.
In our final look at weather, a strong area of high pressure will continue to generate fresh breezes throughout the islands today. We're looking at caution flags in the northwest Bahamas, where those winds will be out of the east around 15 to 20 knots. In the central and southeastern islands, stronger winds still 20 to 30 knots. So we're asking boaters in the central and southeastern islands to simply stay in port. Our forecast for today calls for partly sunny, breezy, and quite pleasant conditions. The high temperature reaching up to about 80 degrees. And tonight we're looking at mainly clear skies with your low temperature getting down to 70 degrees. The extended weather forecast over the next 7 days, lots of sunshine remaining in our forecast during the daytime right through the 7 day cycle. Those breezy conditions will continue for a few more days, but we expect those winds to start letting up by Wednesday or so. So we're picking back up on the weekend, so it seems as though the weekend is going to be another breezy one. So for those of you who are into boating, this weekend is again not a good one for you. LaDon?
Thanks a lot, Basil, and happy Founders Day to the ladies of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, especially to our very own Shashina Roe Farquharson and Ashley Whitney. Enjoy your day, ladies. And that does it for us this morning. For the entire morning team, I'm LaDon Davis. Make it a great day, everyone.